Audrey Hepburn would rather be a mother than a movie star. This central fact has shaped her career ever since she decided to flee the public spotlight back in 1967 after completion of the film Wait Until Dark. I'd been pursuing an interview with Miss Hepburn for years, and she finally agreed to meet me on the beaches of Acapulco, Mexico, where she was doing some work nearby with underprivileged children for UNICEF. She was 60 at the time, and I'm still trying to get over how terrific she looked. The very definition of class. In a moment, Audrey Hepburn.
Barbara Walters is sponsored by Lexus Luxury Automobiles.
February of 1989, Audrey Hepburn arrives at the tiny Mexican village of Chausingo, which has known poverty, malnutrition, and neglect for centuries. The villagers greet her warmly, but they have no way of knowing who she really is. They don't know that the distinguished-looking man with her is Robert Walters, her companion for the past 9 years, and widower of the actress Merle Oberon. They do know this woman must be important because she gets to be the first to turn on their new water system.
Yes.
She must be important. She's allowed to vaccinate their babies and to speak in the town square about her organization, UNICEF.
Today is a happy day.
But they don't know her movies, her acclaim, her impact on the world. They don't know she is the Audrey Hepburn. Still, the children follow her through the town like the Pied Piper, and in their faces, she sees something of herself. She was born in Belgium in 1929. Her mother was a Dutch baroness and raised her in Holland. Her father abandoned her when she was only six. In 1939, the Nazis marched into her homeland, and for the next 5 years, Audrey learned what it was like to be hungry, to be afraid, to hide from the bombs, to simply survive. After the war, she threw her heart and soul into ballet, but she was considered too tall. She had no interest in acting, but took a small non-speaking role in this film called Dutch in Seven Lessons.
That's it. Look, I'm making a film about Holland. I'm only here for 7 days. Will you help me? You will? That's sweet of you.
Then in 1951, she was persuaded to screen test for a Hollywood film. They were looking for an unknown to play a princess who takes a one-day vacation from royal responsibilities. The film, of course, was Roman Holiday. She won the Academy Award for that performance, and for the next 16 years, Audrey Hepburn changed the definition of femininity. She was like no other actress, childlike, vulnerable, and wonderfully expressive.
I could cry salty tears.
Audrey also looked different. Tall, bone thin, and wearing fashions by Givenchy, Audrey created a look.
Is it fun? Or should I run? How long has this been going on?
During her 40-year career, she made only 19 films, but had at her side some of the greatest leading men in Hollywood. Usually, the men were much older, and Audrey's character hopelessly in love with them. She married and divorced twice, first to her co-star in War and Peace, actor Mel Ferrer, and second to Italian psychiatrist Andrea Dotti. She had two sons, Sean from the first marriage, Luca from the second. From the late 60s until her death, she lived quietly in Switzerland with Robert Walters and their Jack Russell Terriers. Her last successful film was in 1967. It was called Wait Until Dark. It was a huge hit, but surprisingly, it marked the end of her full-time acting career. Audrey virtually disappeared and became somewhat of a mystery. Then in 1988, she was appointed the Special Ambassador to the United Nations Children Fund, UNICEF. When we caught up with her in Mexico, she was at the end of her Central American tour. She traveled the world on their behalf and was a tireless advocate for children. After giving so much, she was taken much too early. In 1993, she died of cancer at the age of 63. Audrey, you were 10 years old when the Nazis invaded Holland.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us Tell us what it was like for you. What was that childhood like for this little 10-year-old?
Well, I tell you, I remember what I remember. I don't know what it was for other children. Mm-hmm. I just remember very early in the morning being woken up by my mother. All the curtains in the house had to stay drawn because we'd been told on the radio that the invading troops were coming into the city. And I peeked through the curtains anyway and saw tanks and armored cars and Germans, you know, piling out of buses with their guns trained on all the windows.
What was it like those 5 years? Were you in hiding? Were you hungry?
Well, the earlier years, we started with food being distributed, and so we really had to scrounge for food. And it was quite serious, but your daily life was quite bearable with the family. Okay, we had less to eat, and or very little to eat, but it's the impressions that are indelible later on, which stay, not the daily life.
What impressions?
Well, like a couple of my uncles being taken from their homes and shot. My one brother was sent to Germany. The other one was always hidden in the underground. I remember very well being with my mother at a station going, leaving for somewhere on a train. And while we were waiting for our train, a great big cattle train pulled in and lots of Jews were loaded on. And I remember a little boy with red hair and a very white face. And I didn't understand at all why he had to go with all those grown-ups in such a funny-looking train, you know, with just a little space at the top. Nor did we quite know at the time where they were going or what was going to happen to them. This, you know, we learned later. But those are things you never forget.
What did this childhood, if you can think about it this way, what did this childhood make you today?
It obviously has made me what I am today, but I don't know quite how. Obviously, within the present lies the past. You know, we become what we are because of our experiences. I think my upbringing, which was still a very old-fashioned one, my mother was quite severe, you know, compared to today's standards. Very Anglo-Saxon, very Dutch. And that also perhaps is, I don't say made me what I am, but what you see has a lot to do with what she, how she wanted
like
me to be.
Like what? What are you that she wanted you to be?
I'm often thought of as perhaps reserved. I've read that I'm considered sometimes a perfectionist, which I'm not. But I think it has something to do with that attitude which I was brought up with, of that, you know, not to fiddle or fuss about yourself, think about it first, don't show off, don't make a spectacle of yourself, I then proceeded to make a living out of making a spectacle of myself. You know, get on with it.
When you were younger, after the war, your heart's desire was to be a ballerina.
Yes, or during the war, too.
Never thought you'd be an actress.
No, never. No, no. In fact, acting, I mean, especially movie acting, in the ballet world of then, wasn't considered serious. You know what I mean? With all classical music and Swan Lake and all of that stuff, going into the movies wasn't something that we ever thought of, you know? It just happened. As I went into musicals to get a job, I got the scholarship. In school, and after a while, I had to get a job, too. Went into musicals and doing odd jobs in television and, you know, to earn the extra penny. When the moment came that William Wyler was looking for a totally unknown for Roman Holiday and came to London. Totally unknown I was, you know, but I'd had no experience.
You know, so many people watching, I'm sure, felt as I did when Roman Holiday was on, that it was the most wonderful, a glorious Cinderella story, everything. Did you love it, or were you scared to death doing it?
No, I loved it. I was, you know, ignorance is bliss also, because as I didn't know really what it was all about, I'd never seen a camera, I was apprehensive, yes, as I've always been about any job. I think I'm more scared today of if I have to attempt something professionally than I was then, because it was like a dream. I'd been given this extraordinary opportunity. I'd learned what a great director William Wyler was. I obviously knew who Gregory Peck was, yeah. You know. And everybody was so sweet and so helpful. And when you're not expected to know, less is expected of you. Nobody could say they'd, you know, hired a professional actor, so I had to live up to it. But that came with time. Much more fear developed with time.
Audrey, every person who has seen a film of yours has their favorite film. But for you, which one do you want to be remembered by?
Out of sentiment, Roman Holiday. Mm-hmm. You know, not because I think it's better than others or whatever, but it meant so much to me, that picture. It started me on this career that brought me so much happiness and good fortune. And
Roman Holiday was your first film, and you won an Academy Award. Right. Who did you beat out? Remember?
Don't remember.
How did you feel?
I was in such a daze.
How did you feel? Did you feel you deserved it? I mean, first film.
No, because there again, you see, I didn't really know the value of an Oscar.
Yeah.
You know, I was so green still. I was thrilled again. I mean, it was like somebody giving me a fabulous gift and I had won this prize. But it's over the years that I've learned to really value what the Academy Award is. So that gold statue has become more and more and more precious to me.
Next, Audrey Hepburn on Motherhood and Hollywood. The leading men that you worked with are the most extraordinary group of actors, probably in films, when I think of it.
And the directors.
And the director. But the leading men are the ones that we would remember more. Gregory Peck, Humphrey Bogart, William Holden.
Gary Cooper,
Love in the Afternoon. Fred Astaire. Cary Grant.
There's nothing wrong with
Sean Connery.
Peter O'Toole. And on and on.
Did you ever have a crush on any of them?
No, because I fell in love with all of them. You know, adored them. I looked up to them. They were sweet to me. I just adored Gary Cooper and Cary Grant and Fred. It sounds sort of, you know, maybe saccharine to say, but it's perfectly true. I never disliked any of them.
When you did Love in the Afternoon, there was some thought that Gary Cooper was too old for you. He was much older than you.
Well, he was much older than myself, but that was also the story of Ariane. The book was that way. Mm-hmm.
Did he mind? Did he feel he was too old?
No, because we were both right for our parts. So I don't think that bothered him at all.
And when you did...
But I do remember, for instance, that when I did Charade, Cary Grant, who was a great taste in everything he did... say that he would do the part, but there should be no love scenes per se, because he also was quite a bit older than myself. No, you know, no kissing and all of that. And I don't think anybody ever noticed it. There wasn't.
There was that wonderful wedding scene in Funny Face.
On the bar. You mean floating when off you, in the barge? The dance.
The love interest was Fred Astaire, and I had read that he said, "Well, in a wedding scene, there has to be something old, and I'm the something old." What is it like to dance with Fred Astaire?
Just as marvelous as people think it would be. Made me feel like a terrific dancer, you know. And he made me a better dancer, too. Made me move better and like it. Just as if I'd, you know, danced with somebody with two left feet, I wouldn't have been so hot. But with him...
When you did My Fair Lady, there were some people who thought that it should have been Julie Andrews since she had starred on Broadway. Did you feel funny about that?
I totally agree. It should have been Julie Andrews. In fact, I told my agent that I didn't want to do it because I felt it should be her. And for some crazy reason, and Hollywood has often been crazy, perhaps because she then didn't have a big enough name, I don't know, they decided to give it to yet another person. So it was only until it was between me and a third person that I accepted. So I felt very badly about that. It was very unjust. And Julie knows it, because the part was rightfully hers. But, you know, that never quite went away. Mm. But I felt I was entitled to do it as much as the third girl. So then I did accept.
Audrey, in 1967, you made Wait Until Dark. Mm. And then it was something like 10 years before you made another film. Now, we've heard all different reasons for why you stopped. You tell me.
Very simple reason, because my son had then reached the age of 6. And
this is Sean.
Sean had to go to school, could no longer travel with me. And in fact, I made Wait Until Dark when he had just started school, and he was not with me, because that picture was made in Hollywood. And I was just miserable. You know, I'd call home and he'd have a fever or something, or he was so far away and I missed him terribly. And I'd longed for this child, and it seemed so ridiculous. I mean, I kept saying to myself, hey, I wanted this child so badly and now I'm separated from him, you know. And it just made me too unhappy, so I more or less quit movies than to stay home. It's not easy. I mean, I think everybody agrees, people who have careers. I have the greatest admiration for women who can do, not both, but all three, mm-hmm. who have a career, who can take care of their husband, and take care of their children.
But you couldn't have.
No, I think I'd go around the bend. I don't have that kind of nervous system. I think I'm too emotional. That gets too much for me. Mm-hmm. I could do three jobs. I could make a movie and shop and cook and maybe do something else. That doesn't wear me out. I cannot deal with too many emotions.
You were married twice. Marriage was very important. True? Both marriages broke up. You have a son from each. So do you say to yourself, since the marriages didn't make it, look at the films I gave up?
Oh, Lord, no.
No.
No. Because that wouldn't make any sense. That is the way my life went. I don't regret for one minute making the decision to quit movies for my children. Had I done it the other way around, I'd be miserable today. If I just had movies to look back on and not have known my boys, you know? Right now, I don't particularly want to do movies. I have this extraordinary thing that's happened to me, to be able to express my need to help children and to care for them in some way. I can personally do very little, but I can contribute to a whole chain of events, which is UNICEF. And that's a marvelous feeling. It's like a bonus to me towards the end of my life. And if this career has left me with something very special, it's the fact that it's left me with this, whatever it is, this voice, this curiosity people have still to see me, to talk to me, which I can use for the good of children. What could be nicer? When you can't contribute anymore, that's when you start feeling old and it feels like the beginning of the end. And that I find loneliness, not solitude, because I like solitude, but that's the kind of loneliness which is, that is sad about aging, if that happens.
You're not alone. You have a man in your life who loves you very much.
I have a wonderful man in my life. I have my Robert. We have so much in common. He's so good to me. He takes great care of me. He gives me that marvelous feeling that I'm protected and that I'm the most important thing to him.
How would you sum up your life if you had to? Look at it quickly as a flashback.
You mean good, bad, or medium?
Good, bad, or medium.
How should I sum up my life? I think I've been particularly lucky. Does that have something to do with faith also? I know my mother always used to say, you know, good things don't, you're not supposed to just fall in your lap. God is very generous, but he expects you to do your part first. So you have to make that effort. And I've been very lucky because I know it doesn't happen to everybody. But at the end of a bad time or a huge effort, I've always had the, how should I say, the prize at the end. My whole life shows that.
There are a lot of younger people out there who weren't yet born when Audrey Hepburn played her last leading role. So here's my suggestion for a rainy, lazy day. You go to the video store and you rent Roman Holiday, Sabrina, Breakfast at Tiffany's. And then late that night, you conclude your personal film festival by watching Wait Until Dark. If you do not find yourself totally taken with Miss Hepburn, then proceed directly to your doctor and see if he can prescribe something for your ailment.
Sponsored by Lexus Luxury Automobiles.
February of 1989, Audrey Hepburn arrives at the tiny Mexican village of Chausingo, which has known poverty, malnutrition, and neglect for centuries. The villagers greet her warmly, but they have no way of knowing who she really is. They don't know that the distinguished-looking man with her is Robert Walders, her companion for the past 9 years, and widower of the actress Merle Oberon. They do know this woman must be important because she gets to be the first to turn on their new water system.
Yes.
She must be important. She's allowed to vaccinate their babies. Audrey Hepburn would rather be a mother than a movie star. This central fact has shaped her career ever since she decided to flee the public spotlight back in 1967 after completion of the film Wait Until Dark. I'd been pursuing an interview with Miss Hepburn for years, and she finally agreed to meet me on the beaches of Acapulco, Mexico, where she was doing some work nearby with underprivileged children for UNICEF. She was 60 at the time, and I'm still trying to get over how terrific she looked. The very definition of class. In a moment, Audrey Hepburn.
Barbara Walters is...
And to speak in the town square about her organization, UNICEF.
Today is a happy day.
But they don't know her movies, her acclaim, her impact on the world. They don't know she is the Audrey Hepburn. Still, the children follow her through the town like the Pied Piper. And in their faces, she sees something of herself. She was born in Belgium in 1929. Her mother was a Dutch baroness and raised her in Holland. Her father abandoned her when she was only six. In 1939, the Nazis marched into her homeland. And for the next 5 years, Audrey learned what it was like to be hungry, to be afraid, to hide from the bombs, to simply survive. After the war, she threw her heart and soul into Fully Expressive.
I could cry salty tears.
Audrey also looked different. Tall, bone thin, and wearing fashions by Givenchy, Audrey created a look.
Is it fun? Or should I run? How long has this been going on?
During her 40-year career, she made only 19 films, but had at her side some of the greatest leading men in Hollywood. Usually, the men were much older, and Audrey's character hopelessly in love with them. She married and divorced twice, first to her co-star in War and Peace, actor Mel Ferrer, and second to Italian psychiatrist Andrea Dotti. She had two sons, Sean for ballet, but she was considered too tall. She had no interest in acting, but took a small, non-speaking role in this film called Dutch in Seven Lessons.
That's it. Look, I'm making a film about Holland. I'm only here for 7 days. Will you help me? You will? That's sweet of you.
Then in 1951, she was persuaded to screen test for a Hollywood film. They were looking for an unknown to play a princess who takes a one-day vacation from royal responsibilities. The film, of course, was Roman Holiday. She won the Academy Award for that performance, and for the next 16 years, Audrey Hepburn changed the definition of femininity. She was like no other actress, childlike, vulnerable, and wonderful.